There are different kinds. There is racing, of course. Less fast, but very exciting, is hill climbing. Much less fast, but hard work requires a form of motorsport which is a partnership between the car, the driver, and a co-driver or navigator is rallying. One of Canada's best rally drivers is Har Chi. This is how he describes it.
It's very hard to define rallying. I suppose the easiest way is to say that it's going from point A to point B in a specified time over a sometimes vaguely specified route by the organizers.
Putting it more formally, a rally is a form of automotive sport in which cars leave a starting point individually at a specified time and are directed to follow a certain route to a specified finish, the point at which all the competitors rally. The person who decides on what the route of a rally will be is the organizer. This is Bob Cox. He's the chief organizer of the 1969 Lobster Rally in Moncton, New Brunswick.
An MGB, 1967. And to commence with the driver's briefing sheet itself, I'll read through it, and if there's any questions, they can be asked at the end of the driver's briefing. Drivers are advised to check the leg end sheet to ensure that they are aware of the appearance of the numeral 1, which does not appear as clear as might be expected. Gas stops are to remain as 10 minutes. However, lunch stops are now 1 1/2 hours, 90 minutes in length. The rally is made up of stages, which are comprised of legs, which are in turn comprised of sections. Each type of instruction will be listed as a section. All checkpointers will have their watches checked and sealed by the course opening car. This is to ensure that each watch is not tampered with and to check accuracy. Watches will be checked and sealed each stage.
The competitors know by now that this year's rally, which will be run in southern and eastern New Brunswick, will be 810 miles long, to be completed over a 24-hour period from Friday night to Saturday. The 810 miles will be divided into three stages. A 1.5-hour food and fuel stop at the end of the first two. There will be no sleep for perhaps the next 30 hours.
And there goes car number one, ladies and gentlemen, Victor Moran and Al Rashour. Here's John Griffin and John Pierce coming with a 68 Volvo. Where are these boys from, Bob?
John Griffin's from Fredericton and John Pierce is from Halifax.
Hope you have very enjoyable trip and very safe night.
Good luck, Bob.
30 cars will cross the starting ramp in this event. They know they will return to Moncton tomorrow night. Where they will be led between now and then is still a mystery to them. Whatever they do, they must obey their given instructions implicitly, sticking to the route designated by the organizer at a specified speed, which will vary depending on the road conditions they will meet. For some of the time, they will need to find their direction by using a compass at night. Later, they will plot their route from given map coordinates. There's a lot of work in the name of the game. The relaxation will come afterwards. What you are going to see is cars driven with zest in sometimes difficult conditions. The navigators have trained themselves to interpret the sometimes deliberately puzzling instructions supplied them by the rally organizer. The drivers, through practice, know their personal capabilities well. The cars are a study unto themselves. They ride on the best of tires. Their springs and shock absorbers are heavy duty. They have auxiliary driving lights. Inside, the cars are furnished with seat belts, fire extinguishers, tow rope, first aid kit, flares, and sometimes two spare tires. In the Moncton Lobster Rally, there are over 130 time controls or checkpoints, one for every 6 or 7 miles on an average. Arriving too early or too late at any one of them earns you penalty points, exactly what you must avoid to be a winner. Percent of the rally is now over. Before the next section begins, a 1.5 hour food and fuel stop. Then stage two takes the crews through 9 hours on the road from 6 a.m. to 3 p.m. Saturday. The Lobster is a rally of national status. Points awarded to the top 10 finishers count towards Canada's National Rally Championship. That, as well as the magnificent scenery and the New Brunswick hospitality, is what draws competitors from Ontario and Quebec, as well as from the Maritimes.
My name is Hart G. I rally because I really enjoy it. I find that motorsport gives me an outlet for some of the frustrations of work during the week. And I've been doing it for about 6 years now. And I wouldn't give it up for, I suppose, another 10.
My name is Paul Manson. I'm a navigator. I rally. Why do I rally? I rally because it's competitive. I'm good at what I do. And that's about it. I enjoy it because I do well at it. I drove my first rally. I rolled my car over and I decided it was cheaper to navigate.
Driver's not only concerned with driving his car, but when he's driving down the road, he's got everything under control. He's looking at the shoulder, and every time he comes to a corner, he's saying, how am I going to go around this corner? But he's saying, if there's somebody else coming around the wrong side of the road, I can easily put my car off to the side or go through the ditch so that if an emergency happens, he doesn't react like the general public does, who just holds his hand on the steering wheel, locks up the brakes, and skids straight into the accident. The rally driver is always thinking, if somebody stopped in front, I could just move around to the right, or I'd have to get off the road or something. He's always thinking how to avoid the accident before it ever happens. So the point is, he's expecting it, and he knows what to do if it does get anywhere near it. And this, I think, explains why rally cars have almost no accidents at all. They're good drivers, but they're thinking not only about how they're driving, but how to avoid anything bad happening, even if somebody else is doing something silly, which I guess the public call defensive driving.
Halfway through the rally, it looks like car number 5, a Volvo 144, is in the lead. Driver John Griffin and navigator John Pierce have scored no penalty points. Dave McNevin and Ken Jarvis in a Mustang are riding in fifth place. At the end, they will finish seventh. Snapping at the heels of Griffin and Pierce in car number 5, figuratively speaking, are Hart G. and Paul Manson in a Renault Gordini. They have acquired one penalty point. Manson is a former national champion navigator. The 130 and some checkpoints in the Moncton Lobster Rally in New Brunswick, as in any car rally, are manned by volunteers from within the sponsoring club. The more persuasive of them succeed in enlisting their friends and colleagues too. The better their checkpoint by way of providing accurate information to the competitors and other amenities like drinks, smokes, and windshield and headlight washes, the stronger are their chances of being voted best checkpoint by the competitors, which brings a trophy of their own to those who only wait and serve.
Because I like the competition, and I'm basically interested in automobiles, particularly smaller cars which are dependent on high performance or good performance rather than brute power. As such, I have a Volkswagen Karmann Ghia which I run, and at 53 horsepower I find it is quite competitive. Most of the smaller ones that are rallying are better roadability and are more maneuverable and better suited to the type of road that rallies normally are conducted on.
I'm John Pierce. I'm a rally navigator. And I rally because I like the competition. I'm not an athletic type, but I do really like competition, and I think this is an excellent form of competitive sport. I also rally because I love getting out in the country. I like exploring back roads. I always have, long before I rally. I love to go out on a weekend and look around the country. And I like to time, keep track of time when traveling. I used to do a lot of this on railroads when I traveled by train. And the whole, all these factors sort of worked into a point where rally navigating seemed to be the ideal sport for me. You have to be relatively cool and collected. I think perhaps some of my drivers don't agree that I'm cool and collected, but nonetheless, you have to be able to work under pressure. You have to be used to working to deadlines, and in my type of work, in weather forecasting, this is something that I have to do routinely. You have to be able to work at all hours, which is also something which I've learned to do. And you have to be pretty good, I think, at mental arithmetic. You have to be able to do a lot of things in your head.
O'clock Saturday afternoon. 80% of the rally is over. Some cars have caught stones in their radiators, some have suffered flat tires and are running late, others have lost their way long enough to be out of contention. It is now 19 hours since the rally started. Fatigue becomes a factor. The rallyists stave it off with a 90-minute rest stop before they enter stage three. The rally organizers are past competitors themselves and have a surprise for those starting out on the final stage of 170 miles.
Diabolically clever of the organizers, don't you think, John, to leave the tricky map section until the end of the rally when people were good and tired? It must have worked its spell.
It was very hard on the navigators, I think. Yes, it certainly came as quite a shock after fairly straightforward navigation to get hit with a map section, which was quite interesting. It would have been comfortable, perhaps, for somebody who'd come fresh out of a good night's rest.
Behind the scenes, scorers have toiled constantly all the while. All the penalty points assigned to every car entered are posted. The tabulations receive very careful scrutiny. Runners conceal their excitement with a screen of composure. The stragglers become philosophical. Those in between still dare to hope. In the sense that these competitors prepare and then check their equipment, develop their special skills, and approach their sport with single-minded concentration, they might be considered athletes. At the least, they are sportsmen. Four and a half hours remain before the gladiators, dry, dusty, and tired, can hear their praises and consolations. Thank you.
17.32.
17.
2/10 from now.
This one here?
Coming up. Anytime now.
Here it is. Here it is. Okay. Got it.
Now, around to your left.
Give me a time check as soon as I get around here.
14 seconds into the minute.
Okay, you better catch up a bit more because that...
Well, navigating is interesting. There are many different types of navigation problems. The most boring thing is when you get a very slow speed on a nice road and you're just driving along and you crank the curta, which is the instrument we use for calculating time. And it's a boring thing when the speed's slow and there's nothing interesting to do. I like it fast, very rapid. The driver's busy, I'm busy, there's lots to do.
That this is a very fast sport, and it's got to be dangerous. This kind of sport on public roads can't be anything but dangerous.
No, I don't believe at all that it's dangerous, and I believe that the statistics will prove, at least ever since I've been riding in Canada, I have never heard of anybody or any bodily injury that would, you know, really put somebody in the hospital for a long period of time, or even any death occurring out of rallying. It's only a matter of skill, I would say. In the back roads, you hardly meet any public in the first place. And when you do, well, you're on your side of the road and you're traveling the best you know how. And you get so skilled that even if something did happen, and this is what rallying is to expect the unknown and be ready to counter it and or to go around it. So this is what we've been practicing for the last 5 years, or any other rally driver for that matter. And this is why I say it's not dangerous.
Mid-evening Saturday, 24 hours and more have passed since the rally began. In that period, there have been nearly 22 hours of continuous driving through southern and eastern New Brunswick. Unofficially, car number 5, the Volvo 144 of Griffin and Pierce, is in the lead with a clean score. Car number 8, the Renault Gordini of G and Manson, is in second place. They are separated from the leaders by one penalty point. Over 800 miles of rally road are behind them as the 24 finishers from among the 30 cars that started enter Moncton's Victoria Park and receive a welcome from wives, sweethearts, friends, and well-wishers.
We certainly had some anxious moments in some parts of the map section. It was very well set out, though, very clearly done, but it was a challenge for all the navigators, I think.
Near the first of the rally, the roads and speeds weren't really too challenging, but they built up towards the end. And looking over the whole thing, I think it was quite interesting from the driver's viewpoint.
Winning navigator John Pierce of Halifax, Nova Scotia, and driver John Griffin of St. John, New Brunswick, summing up. and reviewing their choice memories with Dave McEachran of Ottawa. Each year's Lobster Rally in Moncton, New Brunswick ends with a monstrous bonfire, a tradition which began in 1962 with the actual removal from the landscape of a decrepit barn. The occasion is still called a barn burning, though today the refreshments at this celebration of another year's rally happily concluded are cooked on a charcoal barbecue. The awards banquet of this national car rally in New Brunswick is what gives it its name, for it is Lobster which gets almost all the attention on the Sunday afternoon following the rally's end. 400 pounds of succulent crustacean are enjoyed each year by the rally's sponsors and organizers, participants, and friends from the community at this dinner, which this year was held in a boat club on Shediac Bay. As much of the lobster as remains is then taken home by those who cannot have enough at 50 cents a pound. But back to the event that brings these friends of the Moncton Motorsport Club together, the Lobster Rally. All those who completed the rally are given brass plaques as mementos of the occasion, which they may affix to their car's dashboard. This year, the crew that came fourth overall was Marcel Rainville and Lee Bartholomew of Montreal in a Simca 1204. In third place were Dave McEachran and Mark Chappell of Ottawa in a Peugeot 204. Second overall were Hart G of Montreal and Paul Manson of Toronto in a Renault Gordini. And the winners of the Moncton Motorsport Club's 1969 Lobster Rally were John Griffin of St. John, New Brunswick, and John Pierce of Halifax in a Volvo 144 with a clean finish, a zero score.